Christ, 500 years of God's grace in action. This is the ELCA's official banner for this year, and it pulls together the central insight of the Reformers. We are saved or freed by God's grace alone, which we receive through faith and trust in Christ alone, so that we can live for the glory of God alone, according to Scripture alone. The five solas of the Reformation. This morning we are invited to reflect on what it means to be freed and renewed by God's grace. In our gospel reading, we hear Jesus say, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." But aren't we already free? I mean, after all, we are citizens and residents of the land of the free, home of the brave. But Jesus is not talking about political freedom, or the kind of freedoms we associate with the Constitutional Bill of Rights. Neither is Jesus talking about economic freedom, the kind where we would all love to be free from having to work for our daily bread. Nor is Jesus talking about freedom to do whatever we please, whenever and wherever we please. Jesus is offering us a much deeper, more profound kind of freedom. We might call it existential or spiritual freedom. I think of it as a foundational freedom that grounds us, shaping who we are and how we are in the world. Jesus says we experience this foundational freedom as we come to know the truth, and that this liberating truth emerges from continuing in his word. In other words, the truth that makes us free is rooted in our ongoing relationship with Christ, in our abiding commitment and loyalty, our faith and trust, not just in the words of Jesus, but in Jesus, the Christ, the one who is God's word made flesh. The truth that frees us flows from God's heart into our own hearts. An important part of that truth is Jesus' statement that everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. In this sentence, sin has two meanings. First, we have sin with a small s. This refers to the things we do or do not do, the words we speak or don't speak that miss the mark. It's easy to recognize when we commit sin, because someone always gets hurt. Even when we try to avoid hurting others, things often get messed up and someone gets hurt. That's because of sin, with a capital S in bold. Martin Luther described sin with a capital S in bold as emerging from a soul in putabatis and say, a soul curved in on itself. A soul curved inward on itself. Imagine a hedgehog. Hedgehogs are those little animals that are famous for their amazing ability to curl up in a ball. When a hedgehog is frightened, it curls up, it pulls its head, its belly, its feet, and hands inside a prickly coat of spines. Hedgehogs also do this when they're hibernating. Curling up in a tight ball is how hedgehogs protect themselves from predators that might try to eat them. Human beings do this too. Here's a picture of a little girl curled up with her head down on her knees, her arms wrapped around everything, holding it all tightly together. Maybe she's cold. Maybe she's ashamed or in distress, sad and lonely, grieving, afraid, frightened. Physical, emotional, psychological, or spiritual trauma causes us to respond just like a hedgehog, disengaging, disconnecting, withdrawing from the world around us, focusing completely on ourselves. Or think of Rodin's famous statue, The Thinker. It was originally called the poet and appeared first as a much smaller figure atop a decorative door on a museum in Paris. And the sculpture is called the Gates of Hell because Rodin was inspired by Dante's poem, The Divine Comedy, which describes a pilgrimage through hell. The thinker, or the poet, calmly gazes down upon the scenes of torment far below him. He occupies an elevated, superior position, detached from the poor souls below. As a solo statue, the thinker seems even more detached, separated from the world around. Notice posture, physically curled inward and totally absorbed in his silent rumination. All three of these figures represent the shape of sin, the soul curled in on itself. So much of the harm and hurt we inflict on each other comes from our tendency to act like hedgehogs, curling up in prickly little balls to protect our most vulnerable parts. So much of the harm and hurt we inflict is a result of misplaced assumptions about our superiority to others, our presumption that our ideas, our perspectives, and our preferences must be right, good, and self-evident. We cause even greater hurt and harm when we label others as lesser beings in order to defend our superiority. When we are the ones harmed by others, we only make it worse by curling up like this little child, pulling all the hurt inside, locking it up, burying it deep within, until it becomes the core of who we are and how we act in the world. This is the shape of sin. But is this the truth that makes us free? The realization that we are all sinners in bondage to sin? That all of our souls are curled in on themselves? Certainly that is part of it, but it's not all of it. The other half of the truth that makes us free is that we are also first saints. Simul justus et peccator, as Luther put it. The truth of our human condition is that we began with original blessing, as beloved children, made in the image of God, created to stand upright, arms outstretched to receive and to give love, to share our gifts and talents, to serve our neighbors. Sin with a capital S in bold came later, as we turned away from God and from each other out of fear, shame, and misbegotten pride. Curved inward on ourselves, we not only commit sin, but have built families and tribes, churches and communities, societies and cultures that are curved inward on themselves, where everyone both commits sin and is sinned against. Curved inward on ourselves, we have even devised religious systems to pay for our sins with animal sacrifices, penances, and punishment, going on crusades in the name of Christ, exchanging property, wealth, and good works for indulgences, which was what Luther was all bothered about. Was the catalyst for Luther to post the 95 theses on the door of the Castle Church in Wittenberg. Curved in on ourselves, we imagine our relationship with God to be entirely transactional. Our material resources and good behavior to be traded in exchange for God's forgiveness and a seat at the heavenly banquet. One of the most precious legacies of the Reformation is the recovery of the truth that sets us free. The truth that God loves us so much that God sent God's only Son into the world not to condemn us, but to save us and free us. The truth that in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, God has acted decisively, permanently, and universally for all people without exception. The truth that God has no intention of leaving a single one of us curved in on ourselves. The truth that Christ is already now at work, lifting up each one of us, beloved children of God, healing, restoring, us so that we can stand upright once more, tall and true, or middling and mindful, or short and steadfast, ready to live and work for the glory of God in our homes and neighborhoods, churches and communities. This gift of freedom and renewal is ours. Receive it in faith and trust. Claim your identity as simultaneously sinner and saint. Go out into the world and be a sinner, and sin boldly, but believe and rejoice in Christ even more boldly. For Christ is victorious over our sin, our death, and in the entire world, as Luther reminded us. Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to stand as you are.